As always, fasten your seatbelts. Fasten your seatbelts, because you're going to get something here that you don't expect. We think, oh, okay, I've got it. I know pretty much what to expect. Remember, our purpose here is to push past the wall of expectations, the prison wall of expectations, and experience more clearly what it is that we need to experience. Okay, what is there to experience? So this morning I was able to push through the walls of my expectations even more. Every day, this is our discipline. This is an everyday practice. You make the push past the walls of your expectations. And of course, once you do that, a new set of expectations will come in. And you just keep doing that. And you keep getting breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough. And we need these breakthroughs right now, to say the least. What is today? Today is the 17th. Well, I believe in the United States, the Republican Convention starts tomorrow. So all hell is about ready to break loose in many ways, not only in this country, but all around the world. It's a collective situation here. Gangsterland. We live in the realm of wannabe gangsters. We're all wannabe gangsters, actually, meaning we all want to change reality. We're gangsters. We're ganging up against God, right? Wannabe ganging up gangsters against God to change reality. But we're only wannabe gangsters. We're not really gangsters. Nobody's really a gangster. There's some that are really heavy-duty wannabe, you know, they're really into it. But they're still just wannabes. No one can harm reality. No one can touch reality. No ganging up on reality can do anything at all. Can you see this? Welcome home. I don't know if you can see that. I can pull this into the picture. Whew. There you go. Welcome home. Welcome home. That's just drifting around here. So we just have welcome home in the house. Okay, now, to get right to it here. I've lived in the Silicon Valley for 60 years, my entire life. Living in this area is very intense. It's a constant push here. And if you use it in the right way, you will use it for innovation. It's a super innovative place. People are very focused here on breaking through expectations. Of course, they're trying to find out a way to equip ourselves so we'll be real gangsters and not just wannabe gangsters. The technology is a way to, one way we use to try and get the necessary equipment to become actual gangsters. But that's futile. But you can use the pressure of an innovative spirit here for another way. And that's what I have done. Okay, so we push through the wall of expectations to see, hey, how can we abide in non-dual, the viewless viewpoint? Is there some way to have guru vision here? We call it guru vision, really. It's a great term to use, guru vision. This is our goal, guru vision. But we're not quite there, you know. We need some innovation, innovative pointing outness to help us out, and that's what I'm doing here. I have that spirit to do that, because for me it's just normal, natural living in this place my whole life. It's just been nonstop innovation, intense innovation, and it's just normal here for us here to make breakthroughs in whatever direction. And so I make breakthroughs in a spiritual direction. It's just it seems to me just natural and normal, actually. It's not a big problem for me. So I just do that. And every day we have breakthroughs. I'm able to get breakthroughs, and I had a very, very wonderful breakthrough today, to say the least. And of course, part of the whole, one of the greatest keys, you might say, indispensable is what's called repentance, mood of repentance, which is to admit we're wannabe gangsters. This is wannabe gangsterville. Okay, this realm, and any belief in realms is wannabe gangsterville. Any belief in dimensions and realms, all that, it's a dream of wannabe gangsterville. So we're wannabe gangsters living in wannabe gangsterville. That's fine. Just admit it. It's goes beautifully after you just admit that, and you have a good laugh and you're relieved, like, well, finally I at least was able to come clean, you know. You know, and then, okay, it's fine. Nothing bad happens. In fact, it's the opposite. Then you say, okay, well, I don't really want to keep being a wannabe gangster. So I don't really want to be a real gangster either. So, and I can't, it's futile. So you start to see the futility of it. And then you say, okay, well, how can I abide in, how can I get free of this? And then we're right into the heart of it right away. As soon as we repent and admit, yeah, I've been a wannabe gangster. Even though maybe you didn't want to be coming in here, you got pulled into it. The whole world pulls you into it. Everyone here pulls you into it. They're all wannabe gangsters here, everybody. But there are no real gangsters. That's a fact. We can't do anything to God. So how can we even claim to be a gangster? We've never done anything. The gangsters have to pass some initiation test where they actually do some harm. We can't do any harm to reality. So we're all just, everyone's just a wannabe gangster, no matter how tough they talk. Which is, you know, salvation for everyone. Nobody's ever done anything to warrant any punishment at all, actually. It's all an illusion. So, we start off with repentance. This is how I have had success, is I see, oh my gosh, look at me, look at what I'm doing, look what others are doing. They're all trying to, you know, I'm trying to pull myself down into Gangsterville. They're trying to pull me down. They're trying to get their gangster status firmed up, you know. And we're all trying to do this. And you see that and you say, okay, let me turn away from that. So this morning in my meditation, I turned away from it. I had this tank. I saw myself driving this tank. And I kind of went down like this and into this realm. And I call it the gangster queen. The gangster queen, the queen bee of positivity, the gangster queen. We're all actually worshiping, the wannabe gangsters actually worshiping the gangster queen. And she's the one who we think can inspire us into being true gangsters. So she was leading me, this gangster queen, and she was kind of going in front of me, like I was like, oh, she's kind of interesting. I wonder where she's going. Let me follow her. And I suddenly realized, wait a minute, where is she taking me? Where is this gangster queen leading me? Suddenly I realized, whoa. I don't want to be here. I don't want to. And so instead of arguing or getting upset, immediately I turned the tank around. I turned, just did a U-turn, real quick U-turn, and started going back the way I came. Okay, so far so good. This is very crucial that you hear this, so let us just relax so far. Okay. And let whatever wow has built up already dissipate. Should already be some wow, because you're saying, wow, this is not what I expected to hear. So a little bit of patience pays massive dividends. This is what I found out. So we gather our nerve before we go any further. We're going on this little scenario. I've made this U-turn. Okay. I'm now going back the direction that I came from. In this tank. What do you think happens next? Or what does your intuition say? Well, first of all, let me tell you, it worked out great. Okay? It worked out great. I was able to make the right decisions. Okay, so I'm not going to lead you into some, like, oh, you know, I got stuck, terrible. No, it worked out great. And it'll easily work out great for you as well. When you make this U-turn out of self-delusion, really. So I was going along now in this tank and said, okay, I'm going back to where I came from. Okay, so this is my intent. And then the road starts to get steep, and I say, huh, I don't quite remember this steep road coming into this realm, following the gangster queen. I said, well, it's a little odd. My mind starts thinking, what's going on? And then the road got even steeper, really steeper. And I said, whoa. I got a tank, but with treads, but I don't even think I can go up. That's too steep. And then I looked up. Well, at that point, my intuition kicked in. And I said, okay, something isn't right here. Something isn't right. And I felt like it's time for the guru to take over, the grace of the guru to take over here. So what I did is I called upon the grace of the guru, and I said, grace of the guru, I'm handing over the driving to you. You're driving the tank now, and I'm going to get in. I'm going to switch over to this bucket seat, and I'm going to swivel it around, and I'm going to look back towards where I came from. And you're going to do the driving forward. I'm going to be looking back. Okay. Bingo. We have a winner. And when I did that, okay, that's the end of the dream. But then I began to evaluate what had happened here. Very wowish, actually, because this is the key to abidance we're talking about here. Now, there's a lot of you that are into the non-dual perspective and getting familiar with it, which is necessary. Okay, and familiarity is key. But there's still this goal of abidance, and we're all a little fuzzy on this, okay, which is why we're not in abidance. So I was able to work that through this morning to a large extent. I don't know how much I can remember, you know, share clearly with you. There is the key to abidance is what I just conveyed to you. Is you turn the driving of your wannabe gangster tank, little model, little toy tank, you know, this is the tank I'm going to use to blast reality into fragments, you know. Let the guru drive the tank. You swivel around, and you're not looking forward because what we see is this road going vertical. It's going more and more towards just complete vertical. And it freaks us out. We say, how can the tank go vertical? In other words, how can I have my vehicle and still go vertical like that? It's not possible. The tank is going to fall. So it looks like you're going to have a fall. But I realize that that's an illusion. But it's a very potent illusion. It's the last illusion to go. And it's very, very, very unlikely, virtually impossible, you'd say, that I'm going to be able to completely dispel that illusion while I still have a vehicle here interacting with people in this world, you know, helping out. Okay, but I know that the Dharma Kings, the grace of the Dharma Kings, gurus, they've already seen through this illusion perfectly. So they're able to drive the tank, and the illusion of verticality doesn't arise from it at all. So they're able to just keep going straight forward, and everything's simple and easy for them. No problem at all. Whereas for me, I would have been freaked out. So what I did was, I said, okay, I'll accept guru vision, which is this flattened out vision of wannabe gangsterville. Nothing has ever happened. It's called guru vision. Okay. I'll accept guru vision in order to be helpful right now. And the remaining continuity fear that I have, I'll give that to the guru and say, it's yours now. And the guru accepts it. He says, no problem. And I'll say, I'll give it to you for now. Like later, I might want it back. And the guru says, no problem. If you want it back, it's no problem. You can have it back. But I say, here, it's your continuity fear. You spin everything that in my life so that my continuity fear is not activated. And the guru can do this. They're able to spin everything in such a way is that our continuity fear does not interfere with guru vision. So by turning your life over to the guru, say you drive, what you get in return is guru vision. Okay, very simple so far. But you're not a guru. Okay, you're not a guru. And that's this is the issue that we need to look at here. So this is what I was just looking at and getting used to this. Guru vision is one thing. Being a Dharma king is something even beyond guru vision. However, from a pragmatic standpoint, in order to be helpful right now, which is very crucial, it's guru vision we need. We already have the gurus. We already have Dharma kings. And there, one is enough, actually, but we have many. And they're able to spin everything. So continuity fear does not interfere with our guru vision. So we can say to the world, yeah, I have guru vision, but I'm not a guru. Just like Longchenpa said, you know, you could, if you like, I can make you a Dharma prince. I said, okay, I'll consider this. What he's saying is, he'll make sure that I have guru vision, but I won't be a guru. So my choice is, do I keep trying to be a guru or do I accept guru vision? So this is the choice that we all have right now. And if we answer it, we'll have guru vision. If we're still struggling with this question, that means we're still deciding, well, maybe I should try to be a guru. Okay. Now, Longchenpa didn't offer to make me a guru. He said, I'll offer you to give you guru vision, Dharma prince. Okay, because he knows that, see, they have completely seen through all delusion of layers and levels and dimensions and everything. And not only that, but they're absolutely perfectly abiding in that with not a trace of desire not to abide in it, with vast familiarity in helping others with guru vision, etc. So that's a real guru. That's what we could kind of call Dharma King, Dharma King Guru. That's the real McCoy. We are in no position to get to that right now. Theoretically, if we keep working out long enough, you know, eventually we can theoretically. Okay? We already are, actually. But to be helpful right now, which is where the help is needed, actually, especially what's coming up in this world, guru vision is what's required. That's the required capacity for us right now. So we have to be, we don't have to be, but being pragmatic is the way to be helpful. Don't be idealistic at this point. Be pragmatic. What does guru vision bring with it? Shining, peaceful mind. Shining, peaceful mind. Confidence, reassurance. Okay. But not the guru. I'm not the guru. So I said, oh, it's fine. Yeah, I like it. I'm getting used to it. I said, yeah, this is... So I'm just trying to settle into this acceptance. I'm not going to be a guru. Fine. I've never said that I'm a guru. It's never been quite my goal, which is why I've had some troubles with those who claim to be gurus. Because then they don't really clearly delineate the difference. And my goal is to be like a Dharma prince, a guru vision. So Longchenpa clearly delineated it, which means Jesus Christ also clearly delineated it. Those are the ones that I really paid attention to, you see, is those who really clearly made this distinction. It's all important distinction, actually, for us. Jesus and Longchenpa really, Jesus theoretically did a beautiful job of it. Longchenpa actually approached me and said, I will see to it that you're a Dharma prince in my court. And so he's more of the action type of guru there. And then Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro said, I'll be your personal driver of your tank. Okay, I said, oh, great. He's a very calm driver. I was watching this video, a DVD of my friend yesterday. Fabulous stuff. He visited all these monasteries, Samye, all the famous monasteries in Tibet, and took beautiful video of all of it. Oh, man. But they were driving along these very narrow gorge roads and buses, and it's just like, God, they're all sitting there like, oh, my gosh, I hope we survive. The roads are collapsed in places and stuff. Well, you know what? I realized you have to really trust the bus driver. You know, and these guys do it for a living all the time. And they're just locked into it, okay? Their dharma is just locked into it. And your life is in their hands, you know, but they just have an intuitive feel for it all. what you need. You need that. Because it is not easy in those narrow gorge roads they're driving. And I shot the Himalaya, Mount Everest, saw Mount Everest. They showed me a vision, a picture, a video of Mount Everest and where you can see it from and everything. It was just an amazing experience. That DVD my friend just gave me on Friday, I think it was. Wow. Yeah. And so I realized you have to trust the driver of your vehicle. If you're going to take a bus ride, trust the driver. And the driver has to be this very, very calm, sedate, unflappable, focused presence, which Jamie and Kenshi Choki Lodro certainly is. You get the feeling that he could drive your bus. He's going to get you there. And really, all this winding gorges and dangerous roads, that's just an illusion that I have. He realizes there's nothing there but a completely flat, safe plane. So he's just driving this completely, and he's not going to get caught up in the excitement of imagining dangerous gorge roads, you know? He's not going to get caught up in that excitement. So one thing about Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro is we have pictures of him, and we have many teachers who have studied under him, Tibetan teachers, and they all talk about what a fabulous master he really is, how calm and sedate and not given to flights of fancy, really, without being like a robotically, he enjoyed the entertainment of the ritual dances and stuff. So it's not like he's robotically calm. He seemed to have a little bit of this humanness of enjoying some entertainments or something. Oh, that's fine. But practically, pragmatically, absolutely centered in clear light, Rigpa, inherent spaciousness vision. Therefore, seeing the complete flatness of all and not given to revelry and crazy wisdom and, you know, wild hair and He showed no evidence of being given to this, really, at all. Under all manners of testing and bringing many people, many to guru vision, helping them come to guru vision. So he's one of these very rock-solid, steady bus drivers who's not going to suddenly imagine a bunch of dimensions and, roller coaster ride. No. The ride is going to be smooth and steady. This is what I'm seeing and getting familiar with, is you have to trust your bus driver when you do this, which is why gurus are so important. At some point, if you want to have guru vision, you need to trust the guru. As Ramana said, turn it all over to me and everything will go well for you. I'll take care of everything. Again, a great bus driver, Ramaharshi, to say the least. Oh, you can't get a better bus driver, Ramaharshi, could you? It's just... He's so great that I don't even think I deserve him. Yeah, this is the thing. Jesus is so great. Ramaharshi is so great. Longchenpa is so great. Sri Sri Anandamayi is so great. It's like I feel like I don't really deserve such like the greatest bus driver, you know? I mean, isn't there some bus driver who's super great, but in my mind it isn't like, you know, just this ultimate bus driver? And then Longchenpa said, yeah, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro. You don't even know who he is, but I'm going to recommend him to you. He's an absolute... solid, great bus driver, you know, super great bus driver. But in my mind, I don't have any, you know, nothing about him really at all. I just, when I first met him, he actually introduced himself to me. He's kind of like, say, I'm going to be your bus driver. I guess that's what he's doing. Would you like me to be your bus driver? And I said, oh, wow. So we have this kind of feeling like, oh, do we really deserve the greatest bus driver? In our minds, at least. They're all the greatest bus drivers, but you know, they all see it's just completely flat, so how could they fail? They see that failure is impossible. The success has already happened. So there's no levels of who's greater or not, really, because once you see that failure is impossible, there's only smoothness. How can you fail to be a great bus driver? You know, it's not possible, actually, at that point, right? So they're all there. But in our perspective of looking at him, you see Jesus, you realize Jesus, my bus driver, oh my gosh, you know, and it might get a little like, I might have too much guru vision. I might, you know, Jesus is going to drive me straight to heaven. Oh, he's going to go vertical on me or something. I don't know. But Jamyang doesn't give you that impression, you know. He's just going to like, just drive it real, a real sedate, calm bus driver. You know, you don't joke around with him. He's quiet. He's focused, you know, and it's just that kind of way, which is helpful for me. I tend to get a little bit excitable, you know, and adamant and fiery. So it's helpful to have this bus driver that's just, you know, none of that really stirs him up at all. It's just really sedate, very calm, sedate, and just boring, you know, bus driver, just keep it, you know, it's always on the road, it's always safe, it's always just smooth. That's it. Just safe and smooth. So I don't have to worry about it. Now, so when someone's driving your bus like that, the guru, the grace of God is driving your bus, then you can just enjoy guru vision and just shine guru vision to everybody. That's all you need to do, which helps their confidence, helps them say, oh yeah, my goal is reachable. But they're still not sure. They think they have to be a guru to have guru vision. No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't. Because what the guru is doing is manipulating circumstances so your continuity fear doesn't kick in. So your guru vision remains steady. Pretty much steady. Steady as possible, but steady enough. So you don't lose it. So you're in abidance. That's the work of the guru. Without that, your continuity fear is going to jump back up and bite you, and then you're going to lose the abidance, you see. And then you're up and down, and nobody knows quite what to make of you. And they think maybe, you know, you're a wannabe gangster. They say, hey, maybe he's one of us, you know. Maybe he can help us, you know. Let me introduce you to the gangster queen, you know. She's really super. We literally love her. I mean, follow her and you can't go wrong. this is literally what's going on. Of course, that's just a projection of our imagination, the gangster queen, but it's a very compelling one. She seems to be very slick, you know, like, oh yeah, no problem, we can gang up on God, I'll show you how, it'll work, no problem. Very attractive, we think, but then where is she leading you? Wait a minute, whoa. Anyway, we all know this at some level, right? And we're all saying, is there some way I can get free of this gangster queen? And sure there is, but then we turn around and then we reach this issue of, we think that we're suddenly supposed to go vertical, like we're going up into some higher dimension, or, you know, heaven's up there, there's a verticality to it, instead of realizing, no, it's always been heaven. Heaven is always everywhere. How could there be a vertical to heaven? There isn't. And that's guru vision, is seeing just the inherent spaciousness. There's no vertical to it. There's no horizontal to it either. It's 360 degree on this, okay. So we've covered this now, and so we can just let it shift it to the back burner for a while. Okay, this is how we do it. We don't try to force issues. And you know, if you're like me, you're just going, wow, this is very helpful. And getting something that's very helpful is stressful because you don't want to fumble it away. It's kind of like you got the football now, so the quarterback has handed out the football to you, and like you're running and say, oh my gosh, I got there's this opening now. I see daylight. I running for a touchdown. Then you start thinking, oh my gosh, I hope I don't fumble the ball. You know, it suddenly puts pressure on you. And what happens? You see the guys are like that. Someone reaches in and they fumble the ball, or somehow they fumble the ball because they're thinking, oh, don't fumble it. So what we do is we kind of call time out. We realize the football game, we can call time out at any point. It's our game. Okay, it's our game. It's like a video game, football game. You know, we can just hit pause. So we got the football and we're running for a touchdown, and suddenly you say, you know what? Yeah, it's wide open and there's the end zone, but I'm going to just hit pause for right now and just freeze frame it all. Just freeze frame it. A and we'll just shift gears a little bit here, and we'll get back to that at some point. So that's just on freeze frame until the wow dissipates, right? This is the whole secret. How do you score the touchdown? Well, you go in freeze frame, you go to the wow, you hit pause. Otherwise, you'll say, I got to grip that football tighter. It's not tight enough. And then you'll squeeze tighter. It's not tight enough. Still not. I got to clutch it tighter. And when you do that, your muscles all lock up. You're locked up. And suddenly, the ball squirts loose, you know. You got to stay relaxed and loose, okay, in order to gently hold the football so you don't drop it. You try to squeeze it too tight, you'll drop it. So we don't want that to happen. So if you can just abide with this in the wow, abide in the wow for now. Until we get to the genuine abidance. So first we abide in the wow. First we abide in the wow. Or first we have non-dual familiarity. Then we abide in the wow. Keep shifting back and forth. And ultimately we'll have guru vision. Okay? Here. Soon. Okay, but not right this second. We're going to hit pause for just a moment. And how long do we have on pause? Indeterminate. I don't have any expectations one way or the other. It's just when we feel like it, we'll take it off pause. Okay. It's like, will it be in time? Well, yeah, I have a tendency to be on time in terms of not being late. Okay. So just trust. I trust that. So it's getting really nasty here in the world. The wannabe gangsters are wanting to congregate in Gangsterville. They want you to go with them. They want you to take them there. And I'm saying, no, no. And then they're getting really nasty. It's a nasty situation right now. Really nasty. This is what I'm experiencing. Most people think it's better to try and be real gangster and gang up on God. If we all gang up on God, we think we'll succeed. Whereas if we don't, we think God will pick us off one by one, you know. Ah, there's that gangster who's trying to destroy me. I want to destroy them. But if we all gang together, God will maybe think that will protect us from God. So there's a tendency for gangsters to want to gang together. But of course, God is not trying to get us or punish us at all because we've never done any harm. We can't harm reality. It's just a silly little childish fantasy we're having of being wannabe gangsters. Imagine a little child with a cowboy belt and some holsters, you know, and he's got little plastic Colts and he's got a little cowboy hat, or he's playing the, you know, like, I'm a bad, you know, cowboy outlaw, and he's like a little two-year-old kind of toddling along, you know, and how cute it is. We laugh. Imagine, the parents laughing at their little children who are playing gangster games, you know, and God's just laughing, you know, just has a good chuckle about it, you know. We're playing like, we can destroy reality. We can harm reality. God's not the slightest bit disturbed or troubled or worried or anything like that, actually. So there's no punishment at all for anyone, actually, because no one's ever done anything, you know. And if we can play the game, we're free to play the game as long as we want to. We're completely free to play this game as long as we want to. This little gangster, wannabe gangster game, little childish wannabe gangster game is what we're doing. God doesn't, there's no determinacy. God says, oh, you know, you can only to play it this long and then you can't. No. Then we wouldn't be free. God creates absolutely free. So everything's completely indeterminate, including this little gangster game. And we can end it right now, or we can keep playing it for trillions of years if we want. Whatever we want to do is okay with God. But feeling this fact helps us choose to set it down, right? Because there's no punishment. So our fear is that God's out to punish us. And so we say, we've got to gang up and have united front. So gangsters united. You know, and this is what's happening in the world. What's happening in the world right now is this tremendous push for gangsters united. And let's all unite together in this positivist gangsterism. Want to be gangster positivists. And let's all... And together, we can gang up on God, actually, gang up on reality. This is what's really happening. The gangster-in-chief in the United States, really, I call him the gangster-in-chief. The wannabe gangster-in-chief is working really hard, along with all the other wannabe gangsters and chiefs, to have a globe where all the gangsters can come. We can all gang up on God together, you know. Together, we're strong, that kind of thing. And this is the mood of the world. Gangsterville. Wannabe Gangsterville, actually. And we say, we gotta really fix Wannabe Gangsterville, you know, our little town of Wannabe Gangsterville. You know, there's something, we gotta, you know, pave the roads better and better sidewalks, better lighting. We gotta be happy in our little Wannabe Gangsterville town. So let's everybody make sure that we do this and get rid of those terrible ones that say we're not real gangsters and we're just play acting, blah, blah. Oh, no. We're, you know, we really are powerful gangsters, really bad criminals, you know. We're really going to get God at some point. And so they want to get rid of the truth here. You know, they want to get rid of God's grace here through positivity. They say, we don't need the grace of God. We got this superabundant positivity that we're positive that we can become true gangsters. That's really what we're all saying. And I include myself, you, everyone. This is the shtick of this world. I'm positive I can become a true gangster. Of course, all becoming would be becoming a gangster, because there's no becoming in reality at all. There's only the fresh, spontaneous appearancing of now. So all becoming is the dream of wannabe gangsterness, including all levels, dimensions, whatever is coming and going, are becoming and coming and going, as Jamyang Kyentse Choka Lodo said, it's an illusion. All coming and going is nothing but an illusion, he said. So any dream that seems to show any levels and layers and coming and going, improving, disimproving, this way, that way, you know, that's all an illusion of, that's all the dream of wannabe gangsterness. Wanting to be a gangster. Now there's sometimes from time to time in this world, well, maybe I'm getting ahead, getting going too fast here. So let's not go too fast here, actually. Now, when the Dharma King's driving your bus, your vehicle then becomes calm. There's no strain on it, and when there's no strain on the vehicle, then this doesn't distract from Guru Vision. Right now, my left wrist is just still killing me. The left is really going to kill us, isn't it? Yeah, it wants to. The wannabe gangsters on the left want to kill the wannabe gangsters on the right. Yeah, and they both want to kill the ones who say, "Hey, we're all just wannabe gangsters, and we can never actually be a true gangster at all. It's impossible." But many know or are aware that the left is set up. They've actually set themselves set up bureaucratically, governmentally, to do some very, very, you know, wannabe gangsterish business. They're trying to give evidence they really are gangsters, you know, but illusions can seem to gang up on other illusions. But that's it. They can never gang up on reality. There's no determinism, nothing fixed to gang up on. You see, reality and the gangster, your gangster mentality says, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? There's nothing to gang up on. Nothing fixed. Just like, what can death gang up on? Doesn't death have to have fixation first? How can death kill what indeterminism is not there at all? So death, you know, we're trying to kill indeterminism, but there's nothing to kill. You know, it's like death is like an idea in search of a non-existent victim. He's looking in search of a victim, but he never can find it. So it keeps killing illusions, you know. But it's never satisfied. He says, no, I still don't feel like a genuine gangster. I gotta kill more illusions. I still don't feel like it. Well, let me kill him this way. Let me kill him that way. You know, it's just still don't feel like it. Wow, what's the matter? And then they rush to the archetype of all cleverness, the gangster queen. Say, hey, gangster queen, you know, please, if I worship you and give offerings there, will you please, you know, tell me how to be a true gangster? And she goes, oh, no problem, no problem. You just have to worship me in the right way. And so you fail and fail and fail, and you come back to her and say, hey, you know, you said you do blah, blah. She goes, well, yeah, but you didn't worship me in the right way. That's just your problem, not mine. You go, oh, really? She goes, yeah, of course. So, yeah, I could tell you the key to being a true gangster. No problem, I know. But you just have to worship me more. I say, what do you mean by more? Well, longer. Longer? Oh, yeah, you only worship me for like one lifetime. You need at least another one more lifetime to worship me, and then that'll do it. So then you do one more lifetime, and still you don't feel like a true gangster. And you go to the gangster queen, say, hey, what's up? You know, you failed me. She says, no. You didn't, when you're worshiping me in this lifetime, it wasn't really committed to time. You weren't really committed to the lifetime. You weren't really committed to me. You were still thinking that maybe I can get wiggle room. So you need one more lifetime where you're really truly committed, and then that's it. Truly committed? Oh, yeah. In other words, like you need to be truly committed to time, and you know. But we, of course, being God created us as absolute, indeterminate, perfect freedom, we can't be truly committed to time. It's impossible. So the gangster queen just strings you along, lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, telling you, yeah, this definitely you can do it this lifetime. You just have to be truly committed to me and worship me in the right way. And if you, when you, as soon as you do that, you know, I'll have the secret of how to be a true gangster. And of course, the secret to being a true gangster would be, if it was possible, that you make time real. So you're worshiping of time, you make it real. It's like worshiping illusions until they become real. This is what Jesus tells us. We're trying to worship illusions and make them real, which is impossible. So really, the gangster queen has just been stringing us along, all along. She doesn't have any secret. Her secret is to make illusions true, but it's impossible. So what kind of key is that? It's like saying you have the key, except there's no lock. There's no lock at all, you know, what? How do I use this? There's nothing to open. I need something that's an illusion that's true so I can open the doggone illusion. Well, there isn't any. So the key's no good. The key, what is this? It's useless to me. I can't be a real gangster. Oh, my gosh. I got to turn around. And then I hit this verticality. Oh, okay. Grace of the guru. Let the guru drive. And it all settles down for you. So we're just getting used to this. And we have to get used to this now because Gangster Incorporated is Gangster United. Gangsters United is the this world right now. Let's all gang up. They call them gangsters for a reason. Ganging up. To take down a powerful foe. Gangsters gang up. And so we're ganging up on God. God said, we got to take down God. And this world is really, really, really getting into ganging up mentality now. Very extremely, actually. Extremely. So, with the positivity cheerleaders saying, go, go, go. They work for the gangster queen. They believe that they can inspire us to succeed. And when they inspire us to succeed, they'll succeed also in being true gangstresses. If you can say that. We're just gangster. It covers it all. So you're looking at this, it's quite hubris because it's true. You know, when you see everything the way it really is, that you can't help but chuckle at it. Yeah, really, because it's such a silly play acting thing, like a little childish thing that, you know, but it's funny. And it's also not so funny as well, but we emphasize the funny part of it. Ultimately, we will have a good laugh at it all. So it's important to, as we go towards the ultimate liberation, which is the guru guru-ness actually is ultimate liberation, dharma kingness. As we go towards that, it's important to laugh at this, how silly we've been, how silly it all is actually. It's been nothing but silliness actually. Everything, all of everything we've dreamed is nothing but silliness. That's all it is. And so we just have a good laugh, and then that's all silliness requires, is a good laugh, actually. A good spiritual laugh. As Longchenpa said, when you see what's really, you know, what it is, it just, you might as well just laugh, you know. That's all. That's the only thing that comes to mind, is just laugh. It's just, okay, so we're just going fast, but not too fast here. So this is our, the art of it here. Accelerate coast. Rabbit tortoise, like that. Now, so like on Facebook, it's very interesting. I see all the gangsters are ganging up on me. Either that, or they're desperate to get out of gangsterness, but I don't see too much of that. There's a few that are non-dualists. And so they are working on getting familiar with non-dual familiarity, which is really good. However, at this point, we need to get into the actual technique of abidance. Turn it over to the grace of the guru. That's actually how you do it. There's a few that tried to do it without the grace of the guru. And out of a sense of just adventure, just let's see what happens. I just feel it's be super adventurous, so let's see what happens. And unfortunately, it didn't turn out well. And whatever positivity they tried to give out, the overall, it all had an overall illusory effect on the world, actually, unfortunately. So there have been some historical figures that posed as gurus, dharma kings, but weren't really. They were trying to get there without relying on the grace of the guru, God's grace. And it didn't work out well for them. It didn't work out well for us. So historically, that is proven to be an extremely bad way to go. And a genuine Dharma king can come into this world already enlightened and go through a play of sadhana like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma just to familiarize herself, put her house in order, as she said, as far as giving advice. That's a different story. And if we try to, and they say clearly, don't try to follow my example. That'd be a great mistake for you. In other words, don't try to do it without the grace of the guru. And some might see that and say, oh yeah, I can only try to be like this. That's a big mistake. It's a big mistake. It ends up throwing a bunch of monkey wrench into a lot of stuff. And really, they're really working for the gangster queen. They claim they're not, but the gangster queen actually tells someone, this is one of the lies she tells. She says, look, you're really special. You're really amazing. And for you, for the others, yeah, I got to tell them that they can get it this lifetime, but, you know, they really can't because they're not able to really concentrate on time properly and make it real. But you're special. I know that you can actually, you're able to actually do it. So I'm going to give you the super special key that I don't even give to these other ones of how to actually, you know, make time real. I know how to do that. And so I'll tell you that as long as you really show that you're super willing to serve me, I will then give you this key, and then you won't have any more lies, guaranteed. And so she tells that lie, and there's some that buy into that lie, and so they really try to do what she says. But she said, don't tell anybody that you're working for me, okay? Tell everybody you defeated me, and then they'll think, oh, okay, they're safe. So, but in hindsight, you see they're working for the gangster queen all along. And of course, they don't make it, because you can't make time real. She doesn't have any secret. It was just another lie, trading in on our desire to be super adventurous without discerning the pragmatic importance here. Okay, because we're not here to show off what a super guru we are. We're here to bring liberation, everyone. This is the Bodhisattva ideal. Okay, now here's another insight I saw this morning. If we can just shift gears a little bit here. Trust the bus driver a little bit. I know I'm taking you on a ride too, it seems like, but I'm being taken on a ride too. So I'm just kind of sitting in the seat chatting with you here. The Bodhisattva ideal, which is Mahayana Buddhism, is that you refrain from final enlightenment until all of us are free here. So you're service to all of us. You're like bus drivers. You drive every single one of us until we're all finally free of all delusion. You're going to keep doing that. So I was given an insight into this. And I don't know how well I can explain it. Now, the Bodhisattvas, they seem as though, since they're accepting our continuity fear and spinning everything, it seems like they may have not reached the final, you know, the final liberation of just complete unawareness of it all, etc. It may seem that they're not quite the top enlightenment sort of thing. Okay, for our perspective, it will probably seem somewhat like that. We're not, you know, this is just a feeling we have. But from their perspective, actually, they've already succeeded. Everything has already succeeded. It's already done. They're just playing this dream role, so to speak. But they know it's already done. So they're actually enlightened. Bodhisattvas are actually enlightened. Fully enlightened, you might say. They know it's already finished. They see that success is so inevitable that it's all right here now. There's no time at all. So they're perfectly aware of that. And yet they play this role. So Bodhisattva is just a role that they're playing, actually. A pragmatic role. So in other words, the Bodhisattvas are the ones who recognize pragmatism properly. But in no way does that detract from their enlightenment at all. But we will view them as perhaps little less than fully enlightened. There are, if we view them as fully enlightened, it won't quite seem that way because they're pragmatically interacting with us in a certain way of driving the bus. But they are enlightened, actually. So don't feel sorry for the Bodhisattvas. they are enlightened. I used to think, oh, poor Bodhisattvas, they're delaying their enlightenment, you know, full enlightenment. No, not really. It only seems that way. It only seems that way to us. It doesn't seem that way to them, actually. But it's reassuring for us to feel, oh, what they're doing is they're just to recognize pragmatism. Now, if you refuse to recognize pragmatism here, then the only goal you have is just, you know, full guruhood, enlightenment, and you might not get that, actually, really. Because we're all one. And you wouldn't be able to function very effectively here if that's the case. And helping, pragmatically helping, you wouldn't be able to do that. You'd just say, well, I'm greater than you are, always will be, and nothing we can do about that, you know, and worship me and stuff like that. And that, you know, that's not really pragmatically helpful, actually. So they can't really be effective here. I mean, theoretically, you could do it that way. The Hinayana way. Theoretically, you can be like that. Arhant. But you can't really help others very much, really, in the right way. Certainly not in the most expedient way at all. And all sorts of problems will arise with that. Because the continuity fear is not being dealt with in the right way at all. And so all they can say is, well, you got to dispel all continuity fear on your own, really. and I'll just be a figurehead to just help you. But they don't really take it on themselves, your karma, so to speak, your continuity fear. All karma is really just continuity fear. They don't take it from you and relieve you of that burden and then drive the bus like that. And no, they don't do that. So it doesn't really get us there now. You know, it's not really expedient. It's not really a good expedient. So the Bodhisattva ideal is a better expedient for sure, way better. You know, immeasurably better, especially now, is we need to call upon the Bodhisattvas. I've called upon the Bodhisattvas. I realized, hey, I said, we need help right now. And you know who answered the call? Longchenpa, a stupendous Bodhisattva. He's the one that showed up immediately, meaning we're all pragmatism. We understand how the pragmatic path works, and that's the one that really works right now. It's fast, it's effective. He's the one that immediately showed up. So I call upon all the Bodhisattvas, the grace of all the Bodhisattvas, to be our bus drivers now, and to drive our vehicles, drive our tanks. Actually, our buses are fitted with turrets, you know, and muzzles, and you know, all bristling with armaments. And drive our tanks, Bodhisattvas. And of course, if we look at a Bodhisattva driving the tank, we might think, huh, they're not really enlightened, are they? Why would they be driving this tank? Because this is pragmatic help, that's why. But they already see it's an illusion, you know, and it's just your imaginary vehicle. It's not their imaginary vehicle, but they're accepting it as temporarily as their own imaginary vehicle too. But they already know how it ends, and it ends right now. Alpha and Omega is both now, actually. So they're not really confused in the slightest bit. Even though the ego might jeer them a bit, you know, see, you only have a Bodhisattva helping you. I can get you a real guru. No, the Bodhisattvas are real gurus. Okay, the Bodhisattvas are real gurus. They're the ones, and they're pragmatists, which means they're working with the plan of God's grace to liberate us. Now, God does not bar the door for us to be liberated instantly without using His grace. No, that's part of our freedom too. So we can try to do it that way. Some do, but it doesn't really, hasn't worked out well at all. And you can see why it wouldn't, because of the continuity fear. That trips it up. They're not, you know, they think they can just bully past it or something. So I should just be able to just, you know, leap right past that. Well, no, what happens is they can't leap past it, and then they con everybody into worshiping them as if they have, and to make themselves feel better about the fact they couldn't leap back. And they think, well, the only thing I can do, I can't leap back into reality, so the only thing I can do is set up shop here and serve the gangster queen, and end up being the consort of the gangster queen, and that's the highest I can do, so I can get everybody worshiping me so I feel better about my failure. You know, it ends up like that. Ends up like that, spiritual egotism. So, but theoretically, yes, we any of us can immediately drop all illusion immediately and forget all about the world, the universe, all pragmatism, everything. Absolutely, and just experience our freedom, perfect freedom, without doing anything else. That is, we're absolutely free to do that. God doesn't put any obstacle at all in front of us to do that. But our own continuity fear, which is extremely severe, is absolutely blocking us from doing that. From a pragmatic standpoint, it is absolutely blocking us, okay? So it seems to suddenly go vertical, the road, and we're so insistent on driving down a road that we feel we can't go any further. So we're blocked. So turn it over to the grace of the guru. The grace of the guru is able to drive our vehicle along this road that presumably takes us to heaven, quote unquote. And they know it doesn't go vertical at all. It's just all 360 degreeness right now. It's all just a simulation. We're really just in a simulator, you know, right? Driving down this road. And it's all just flatland, beautiful flatland, so to speak. Now, is this intense enough? Well, we just have to go as fast as we can go right this moment. Again, I have my history has been to not be late. So I just have to trust in that, you know, but it's and not even think about it really. Because the Gangsterville is really wannabe Gangsterville is they're really ganging up right now. Really bad. Really bad. They're moving all the chess pieces now to try and pull us all. Now, why do gangsters wannabe gangsters try to pull us all into their little gang? Strength in numbers. Okay, strength in numbers, of course. Because they say, well, I don't feel like I can quite gang, you know, destroy God by myself. But then, so and my little groups doesn't seem strong enough. But if we get all these little groups together, you know, maybe we can do it. Yeah, that's the only hope we have. So they're always trying to gang up more and more and get the groups together, and we could get, you know, together we could do that like that. So they always want to somehow control society, control everybody, so they can force them into the gang. It's like force conscription into their gangs. They want to force everybody into their gang. They think that's the only way they're going to succeed. So they want us all to be certified members of their wannabe clubhouse gang, you know, Tree Fort gang, basically, little Tree Fort gang. Yeah, we're Tree Fort gangsters. Wow, you know. Look at our, you know, gangster hats and gangster clothes and belts and bells and whistles, and hey, I whipped out my gangster smartphone on you know, and I'm taking gangster pictures of you, and wow, I'm a really hip wannabe gangster, and I got all these other hip wannabe gangsters in my little tree fort. And this it's like that. It's like a little tree fort cult they have going here. But what they're doing now is they want everybody to be part of that little tree fort cult. And so they're tightening the screws, to say the least. And of course, some are saying, ah, you know, I don't really want to give up being a gangster, but I don't really want to join your little cult, you know, Tree Fort cult. I kind of want to just, you know, I want to give it some more consideration. I'm not quite ready for that. And so they're trying to say, whoa, whoa, not so fast, not so fast. So you have this liberal, conservative polarization in the world, really. It's not just the United States, it's all over the world. It's strongest in the United States because United States citizens are able to defend themselves from the government, from government intrusion to some extent. Oh, it's getting, you know, it's very difficult now. But that's the idea, is the last defense against tyranny is citizens being armed. And so the Tree Fort wannabe gangster cultists are trying to disarm all the Americans. It's all important to them. Because then they can try to, you know, force us into their little tree fort gangster wannabe cult. And so the American, you know, the conservatives, they're not enlightened or anything. Okay. They're just saying, whoa, 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 not so fast. I'm not quite ready to join your little wannabe gangster tree fort cult. Not quite yet. I'm still thinking about that Jesus guy, you know. You know, it's like, I'm not sure Jesus would want me to do that, you know. Yeah, I went to church, and yeah, I read the Bible, and yeah, you know, right, and but and I know you're saying that no, that the gangster queens is really knows where it's at, and Jesus is actually just her son, you know, who, and he's not quite really clear, but she's really clear about it. But I'm not quite ready to abandon Jesus yet. Okay. So those are what you'd call the conservative faction around the world. They might say, I'm not quite ready to abandon Buddha yet. I'm not quite ready to abandon, you know, this and that yet. But I'm tempted, but not quite yet. So you're going to have to wait a little while. This is what they're saying. That's all they're saying. It's not that, again, the conservatives are not some enlightened, wonderful people who know the truth and how to. No, but at least they have the seed, this little plant in their yard that says, you know, maybe someday this might grow up and to be a big, beautiful tree with abundant fruit everywhere. Right, yeah, right now it's kind of small. But Jesus told me if I kept watering it, you know, and taking care of it would eventually grow. So I don't want to quite give up on it yet. Okay. It's like that. It's just like that. I mean, you just don't try to put it into issues. You lose sight of what's really going on. They're just saying I'm not quite ready to join your little tree fort wannabe gangster cult. And I know you're saying, yeah, but this is the strength in numbers. Yeah, I know. But all your arguments, I hear it, but I'm not quite ready yet because I'm not ready to pull up this little tree that I planted, you know, that I've been working on my whole life. And my parents and ancestors have been working on it for, and, you know, my religious tradition has been working on this for a long time. And they say, look, you got to stick with it. Don't give up. So I'm not quite ready to give up yet. So yeah, like half the country's not ready to give up yet, and the other half, they've already given up. Said, nah, the heck with it. Let's strengthen numbers. Let's get everybody in our little gangster cult, and then we're going to win. And so this is what's going on around the world, between conservatives and liberals around the world. Again, conservatives are not strongly on the path of enlightenment. Their tree, they got the little tree growing. It's not yet bearing fruit for them. Okay, understood. So they're a bit, you know, unruly themselves. They, you know, they got some issues they have to sort out for sure. They got continuity fear they got to evaporate. But it's not going to help them to pull up the tree, a little tree of faith that they've planted. Even though that faith is very ragged. Yes, yes. Jesus understands that. Everyone understands who has some wisdom. Of course, it's going to be ragged. What do you think? We're continuity fear really gets us dances, has had us dancing very crazily, you know. And you're used to dancing really crazy. When you start smoothing it out, you kind of think this is weird, you know. This is a weird dance I'm doing. Imagine somebody who's just doing some super rave crazy dance, and then they start smoothing it out to more graceful, calm dance. And even coming into meditation, they might just say, whoa, this is weird, you know, really weird. I'm not used to this. And it's like that. So it takes a while to slow down that crazy dance, of the crazy wannabe gangster dance they were doing, yeah. It takes a while. And eventually, like Ramana says, you turn the overhead fan off, but the fan keeps turning, keeps going around for a while. It takes a while for it to slow down. Sure it does. But you've already pull it, and so that little tree is growing in your yard, and it'll keep growing and growing and growing, and eventually it'll bear this splendid fruit, sublime fruit, that you can will be feasting on forever. So they're saying, nah, I don't want to pull it up yet. I hear you, maybe a little later, but not quite yet. And this is just driving the liberals nuts, because they say, you know, hey, you know, we're feeling like God, you know, God's out to get us and doesn't like us, and we gotta, they're saying, you know, now that we have this technology, we can succeed. We can all form one gang, and that'll work. So they finally see their nirvana is just one gang, and that's gonna finally defeat God. So they don't want all these separate little gangs around. You see, they're a corporate sort of thing. They want to incorporate the whole world into just one gang. They don't want all these separate little corporations around. They want just one big corporation. So I know liberals always seem to be against corporations. They are, you know, because they want just one corporation. So they're not against the corporate idea at all. They just don't like all these little separate corporations. Just like the big bankers, they're not against banking. They just want to have one bank, theirs. They don't like all these little, you know, savings and loan and credit unions everywhere. No, they want to crush all of them. Same thing. So that's the liberals. The liberals want to crush all these little gangs and bring it all into just one gang. One corporation. So they want, you know, the gangster queen incorporated to be just the only corporation there is, and we all are slaves, servants and worshipers of Gangster Queen Incorporated. This is how the world is going now. United Nations, the Pope, the President of the U.S., the various heads of state all around the whole world, they're all little, you know, servants of Gangster Queen Incorporated. And the United States is one of the last places in the world where people are saying, "Hey, wait a minute, not so fast. Why do we need to rush into pulling uprooting our faith? Why should we rush into pulling it up? Yeah, we might be a little ragged, and they are. Okay, there's some few things they got to work out for sure. But they still got that tree growing in their yard. They're still putting water on it. And what Gangster Incorporated wants us to do, or Gangster Queen Incorporated, is that she'll say, "Hey, I got a perfect solution for it. You can have your cake and eat it too. A compromise for it." And they say, "Oh, really? Oh, yeah," she says. "And this is the compromise. And just ask yourself if this is really what you want, okay? Because this is really what we're being presented with." So give yourself just a moment here to gather your nerve. Just gather your nerve. That's all. Just wow. Just wow. Wow is a gathering our nerve, really. It's the way to gather our nerves to go further. The gangster queen says she has the perfect solution to make everyone happy, to bring us all together into Gangster Queen Incorporated. And she says, "Look, you can have your cake and eat it too." And we said, "Really?" He goes, "Oh, of course you can. Trust me." I said, "Oh, really? How's that?" We're kind of like, I don't know if I can really not trust it. Okay, she says, here's her solution. Okay, you got this little tree, okay? If you call it faith, whatever, okay. But you're attached to that tree. We can understand that, You put a lot of care and attention, watering, fertilizing, trimming, protecting that tree." He says, "Okay, it's just something you want to do. We're okay with that. We'll say okay. We're not going to judge you for that. And we know you, since you're attached to it, you've got a continuity issue. You don't want to get rid of it. We understand that. We're very understanding about continuity fear, blah, blah, blah. Okay, yeah. So far, so good, right?" He says, "Well, yeah, okay. So all you got to do, what we're just going to do, is we're just going to start watering it a little less every day, That's all. A little less fertilizer, a little less water every day. That's all. That's all you have to do. You like that? So far, isn't that good? So yeah, you can keep taking care of the tree. We're just going to regulate how you take care of the tree. That's all. And so we're just going to for you know we're just going to cut back on the fertilizer a little bit because we've got to use the fertilizer for other stuff. It's important, right? And we've got to cut back on the water you give it because we've got to use the water for other stuff. It's a little more important than that. But you can keep fertilizing. You can keep watering. No problem. A little less protection for the tree. A little less care and pruning for the tree. All that stuff. We're just going to regulate it. So, and then some, well, how are you going to regulate it? Well, there'll be some fees and penalties, if you water it too much, sure. But, you won't, it'd be so easy to comply with it. You don't have to worry about that." "Oh, really? Wow, I don't know. It's like, what kind of punishments are you talking about if I water it too much?" "Well, I don't think it'll ever get to that, right? I mean, we're very understanding about your continuity fear. So, we'll work with you. We'll work with you." "Okay, but like, what if I make a mistake and like I water it too much or something according to your regulations? And I don't really know what your regulations are going to be, but I'm kind of a little bit worried about what kind of punishments you're talking about." "Well, like I said, we don't really think it's ever going to get to that, so there's really no need to talk about it, right?" And you say, "So how do you like the deal? Isn't that super reasonable?" "Well, a couple things we'd say that we're not too a little jittery about. One is just what are the regulations going to be, and what are the stipulations for changing the regulations and tightening the regulations through time, and what kind of ironclad agreement can you give us that the regulations that you that are brought forth now won't be changed later, right, to be more severe, and what are the punishments in case, let's say, you tighten the regulations more and I can't meet them? what are the punishments for that? So in other words, that whole downside, you're not saying anything about it and are refusing to say anything about it. So this kind of, you know, the BS meter is sort of going into the red zone here. I'm very concerned about this. I guess something's telling me like this is kind of like a very tricky deal. It's, you're only presenting, you know, the so-called the reasonable compromise kind side of the thing. But what is the other hand holding? You're presenting me the open hand, but what, you know, the other hand is right now, it looks like a fist to me. And then, of course, the Gangster Queen Incorporated will say, nah, you've just been listening to Fox News too much or something, or, you know, you've been reading the wrong, you know, you're just paranoid. You're paranoid. So they have that cover too. Yeah, let's say, well, you know, it's just right now you're not thinking clearly. You're paranoid. So, you know, so that's your problem. I said, well, wait a minute. I mean, you haven't. It sounds like I'm being very reasonable. You presented the upside. Now, there's always seems to be a downside to deals. What's the, you know? And I pointed out to you very clearly what the downside could be. I mean, you say there are going to be penalties, but you won't say what they are. How am I being paranoid? It seems like you're trying to be a gangster more than I'm being paranoid. Okay. Sounds like the Gangster Queen is trying to run a racket against us to, you know, up her own gangsterness. So she's just serving her own, you know, gangsterness there instead of being reasonable at all. I don't see, how is it reasonable to hold back in secrecy the downside of punishments and refusing to say how are you going to deal with swings, you know, we'll say, well, don't worry, we'll be reasonable. Well, sure, trust but verify. So you want me to trust you? That's fine, but let's verify it also. Oh, no, you don't trust me. Well, I think in this situation, in this world, pragmatically, we would like some verification as well. That was only reasonable. And so you see, these two sides are absolutely, you know, the Gangster Queen will not say what the penalties will be. She will not say what the regulations will be. She will not, and so we're thinking, hey, what she really wants to do, us to do, is to ultimately stop watering the tree altogether. That they'll make the penalties so severe, what she'll do is say, well, you overwatered it now. Okay, this is what the penalty, I'll tell you what the penalties are. Some of them. And you say, okay, you overwater the tree because we had this shift, okay, you're doing fine. Starts out real fine. You're hitting the marks, that's great. And then she says, well, we need to tighten the water rationing a little bit on your tree. Because the other stuff's like really important, the positivity we got going is really important, so we need to shift some of the water there, so we're just tightening it down a little bit, okay? And they tighten it down, so you go over. She goes, oops, you went over a little bit. She goes, no problem, keep going, it's not a problem. I say, what do you mean not a problem? Well, it's not a problem right now, don't worry. See how reasonable we are? Keep watering it. And then they shift tighten it more, and then you're a little bit over more, and she'll say, don't worry about it, we'll make adjustments, you know, when necessary, you know, don't worry about it. You say, huh, that's pretty big of you, huh? Where's the penalties? No penalties yet, and we'll work with you and adjust it. Then once you've gone over their strict unreasonable rationing thing, at some point she'll say, you know what, we've had this really unexpected opportunity of to make positivity actually work. And because of this, it's like all important. And this is the greatest opportunity we've ever had. So we're going to have to bring you into compliance right now. And you say, what does that mean? Well, it means that all the water you've gone over, which we didn't penalize you for, right? Weren't we reasonable? Well, so far, you know, but he says, well, we're going to have to apply that to right now as far as we're going to have to minus that from your account. So that means you have to not water all this amount to bring your balance back up to level where it needs to be, right? So you, no watering for the next couple years of your tree at all. Okay, so then that will bring it up to zero again. Instead of deficit, now it's zero, and then you can start watering again. You see that? That's very reasonable, right? Because this emergency came of opportunity. You know, we didn't expect that this opportunity comes as quickly, but wow, you know, it did. So I mean, it's just, you know, what can we do? I say, well, wait a minute. If I can't water this tree for a couple years, the tree's going to die. She goes, well, yeah, maybe not. That's not my problem, actually. I mean, you're the one who went over the water rationing, and we were very reasonable with you the whole time. And I said, why do I have this feeling that actually you had all this planned out ahead of time? So you would seem reasonable all the way up until you become completely unreasonable and insist that I kill the tree. Is this ringing the bell in any of us here? Is this saying, hey, and of course they're going to say we're paranoid, and most of them will just say, well, hindsight will determine whether we were paranoid or whether you were trying to be, you know, gangsters. Well, you know, hindsight will make that clear. So we'll find out, won't we? What is what through hindsight? Oh, no. Let's rework the game. No, but, dude, it's just a shuffling of the same cards, isn't it? The goal is to not get us to water at all. And however they work the deal, that's how they're going to ultimately work it too. Of course. Because their goal is to get everybody to gang up on God, ultimately. They don't want you watering that tree of faith. Because the tree of faith will ultimately bear the fruit. It tells you, you know, you don't need to gang up on God. You can't gang up on God. Nothing has ever happened. We're all just little childish gangster wannabes, at least a silly little dream. It's a silly little gangster wannabe dream is all. So this, we're getting to it. You just feel the slyness here as I brought this out into the open, spilled the beans on the gangster queen. Let me do a rap song about that. Spill the beans on the gangsta queen. Yeah. Like that, right? Maybe, you know, in your gangster wannabe-ness, we can do a little rap on that. Yeah, I spilled the beans on the gangsta queen. Now, it's really been seen just how the limousine drives down the road to set the scene so I can be deceived into being a wannabe gangsta lean, man. Come on. Spill the beans on the gangsta queen. Spill the beans on the gangsta queen. Okay. I've never done rap, so I don't know how to do rap. And people say, but you're good at it. You know, you could do rap. Well, yeah, I could do it, and I could also not do it. Not doing stuff's a pretty cool skill, isn't it? So again, we're just gathering our nerve. That's all we do. We just gather our nerve. It takes a little while. You know, don't try to fake it like, oh yeah, I'm so hip. I didn't even shake me at all. Well, if you were so hip that this didn't shake you at all, if any of us were so hip this didn't shake us at all, we'd already have guru vision, actually. Because there'd be nothing standing in the way of guru vision. So if you don't have guru vision right this instant, this certainly has to shake you up, hearing this. Has to. Because this is what's holding us back from guru vision. Which means we're removing the obstacles. It was like, oh my gosh. Guru vision, here we come. So gathering our nerves is very important, skill to gather one's nerve. Don't do it by drinking coffee. That's fake. The wheels will come off at some point because you'll get to something really far along and suddenly even the coffee won't help you gather your nerve. And then you'll start getting all panicky, actually. You'll end up with panic attacks. This is what's happening to people that are having panic attacks right now. The coffee drinkers, they certainly are. I'm not having panic attacks. I'm under stress, sure. So let's call upon all the bodhisattvas now. Bodhisattvaville, you know, bring the bus drivers in. You know, drive our vehicles for us now. It's your time to shine. Start driving our vehicles. Give the bodhisattvas the wheel of your vehicle. Give them the wheel. And say, yeah, I'm not a guru, no, but I have guru vision. You can say that. And that's what's really pragmatically helpful. And of course, the Gangster Goddess Incorporated, will say, nah. Why would you want that if you could be a guru? Why don't you be a guru? Well, because that might take me really, really, really a long, long time still, if I don't accept the grace of the guru. And God's plan is accept the grace of God as the quickest way, the best way. So I would be pragmatically not helpful right now, which fits right into your little plans of incorporating just one corporation in the world, right? So of course you don't want me to be pragmatically effective now. That's why you're trying to offer me a higher position if you just don't be pragmatically helpful now. But that's, you know, just being, that's against the bodhisattva ideal and the grace of God ideal and the Holy Spirit ideal. The Holy Spirit's grace is pragmatic. What actually works, not idealism. So we'll accept guru vision because the bodhisattvas told the grace of God has told us this is the fastest, most effective way to help everyone. And we'll trust in them. How about that? So, you know, game on now? What's the game? I mean, we're not going to be incorporated into Gangster Queen Incorporated. And many, many are temporarily, you know, for a while. Then they'll realize it really didn't get them what they wanted. They'll split off from a little fragment off again. And it just goes on and on. This fragmentation, coalescence, fragmentation, incorporation. It just keeps going on and on, just cycling like this. That's all. So we will not be incorporated. That's all. There's no game going on. We'll just accept guru vision. Seeing the absolute flatness relative to intrinsic spaciousness. Nothing has some sort of level. There's no levels to intrinsic spaciousness at all. Everything seems 360. It seems flat as far as our expectations of depth go. And everything has this 360 degree inherent spaciousness. It's just all 360 degree. So there's no depth. There's no You know, there's no, you can't measure any depth if there's no, if everything's 360 degree everywhereness. How can we measure depth? There isn't any. It's all the same. There's only the sameness. And so we cannot buy for, you know, put levels into the, into sameness, right? So perceptually, we would call it flatness. That there's no contrast in intrinsic spaces. There's nothing. There's no play of contrast in regard to judging and measuring. There's no judgment. In other words, the judgment flattens out. All our judgment flattens out. All our regrets flatten out. Judgment flattens out. And we see a 360 degree inherent spaciousness. That's guru vision. Very reachable for all of us. So all of you who have been on a non-dual path, it's very reachable. You just have these little key clarifications. Let the Dharma kings drive your bus. Let the Bodhisattvas drive your bus. Let the apostles drive your bus. Let the saints drive your bus. Let the grace of God drive your bus. Let the Holy Spirit drive your bus. It's all, those are all labels for this, just the grace of God. That's all it is. And since we think we're a person in a vehicle, it helps to feel that there's a bus, actually a bus driver, you know, in the vehicle, so to speak. So we instead of being completely abstract, it's helpful to think of a guru or some, you know, some saint or whatever, and they're driving our bus. You could have Saint Jude drive your bus, or Saint Paul, or whatever, right? Like that, it helps. We could go totally abstract and we just say the bus is driving itself. Yeah, you could, but that's not really that pragmatic. You might start freaking out at some point. How are we doing? Are you kidding me? It's already an hour and a half. Wow. So I'm under god-awful pressure. I can feel the chess moves against me here to incorporate me, most certainly, to pull me into Gangster Incorporated. Gangster Queen Incorporated, actually, is what it is. There's no doubt about it. I have discovered this through and through and through, that at the top of this effort is this gangster queen, which simply represents what we think is the most positive viewpoint we can possibly, gangsters can possibly have, to inspire us in a positive way towards incorporating, ganging up into one corporate gangsterness, that, and then she'll give us the answer how to defeat God. And so we've just projected, mentally projected this gangster queen who shares our objective and has the answer for us. And so we're those who are along trying to be gangsters, either consciously or subconsciously, are following that path of the gangster goddess, following her, being attracted. She may be walking up in front of them a ways, but you know, they're kind of following at a distance. Oh, there she is. Okay, let's keep going that way. Oh, I see her over there. Okay, let's keep driving. And she just leads us like a Pied Piper into deeper and deeper darkness. Gangsterness. Wannabe gangsterness. Now, there's, of course, there's some bodhisattvas that have female forms, are identified as female forms, absolutely. So not we're not saying that females are inherently gangster, following the gangster goddess. No. It's just that the gangster goddess is how we are most, you know, most effectively attracted to being gangster, following that gangster direction. She's the most sly, the most reassuring, because she's the one that tries to market this deception of tricking us into joining that she a compromise. You know, because the ego, whole thing is a deal that seems to be a reasonable compromise, but ultimately ends up to be a death blow to you. Okay? And so she's able to try to reassure, as your doubts arise, like, oh, wait a minute. Oh, no, don't worry. I'm very reasonable. Okay? Oh yeah, do you believe in God? Oh, of course I believe in God. So you actually had experience like this. I said, do you swear to God that you will not cause me a problem? She says, I swear to God, I will not cause you a problem. And once she got me in her clutches, boom. She laughed at me. Says, you don't really expect me to honor any such stupid little swearing to God like that. I don't even believe in God. So sure, the gangster queen will talk about God and how she believes in God and she promises to God she won't, she'll take good care of you and blah, 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 blah. No, totally will break her promise. I've directly experienced this. I tested it out, actually. The Holy Spirit had me test this out. It was like, wow, you cannot trust at all. Their goal absolutely is to kill that tree of faith that you have in your yard. Suddenly, gee, guess what? We let all that slide going over, we didn't penalize you. That was really big of us, you know. We could have really hit you hard back then, but we let you have your faith for a couple more years. But now we really have to put the water diverted over to here because this is all important. And you're just being selfish to ask the water to you. So we have to apply the penalties. I mean, after all, we did say there'd be penalties. So now we have to apply the penalties now. So no water for a couple years for that tree, you know. Good luck. Good luck. We don't want the tree to die. Of course not. We don't want your tree to die. So this is the gangster goddess. She comes on the scene. We pat you on the back. We don't, you know, like a mother. We don't want your little tree to die, Janie or Jimmy. No, we don't. Of course we don't. We love your little tree, and we want it to flourish, you know. But sometimes things happen, and you know, you have to understand that other people need the water too. We're watering our trees of gangsterness over here. And you have to play fair. We told you about the penalties, and okay, but we don't want your little tree to die. I know it's important to you, you know. And so she acts like this mother, you know, to trying to convince a child to go along with what the child knows is bad for it. How many of us have not experienced that? We've all experienced that, the mother conning us into something we knew wasn't right. But she's so kindly and gentle and pinch your cheek. Oh, there's a tear. Let me wipe the tears away. Here, let me get a cloth. I'll wipe the tears away. And you're still saying, no, I don't want to do this. She says, oh, poor baby. Yeah, that's the gangster mother. That's the gangster queen right there. That's the gangster queen. In her gangster lean, trying to clean up the scene. What she's saying is, of course we're going to kill your little tree, Janie or Jimmy, and gee, we're going to feel real bad about that, you know that? But we're going to, you know what, we're going to make it up to you. Because we got these other trees over here that we're watering, and man, are those going to give you great fruit, man. So you don't need to worry. You're going to be really well happy. You know, you're going to be really happy. This other thing, I know, and we're going to feel real bad about it. And we're going to honor that your sorrow. But we have ways to treat that sorrow. Don't worry. Well, wait a minute. You want me to give up on reality, and you say you have ways to treat that? That sounds kind of gangsterish to me, you know. I don't want to be a gangster. Oh no, but you see, we have ways to treat the remorse, you know, that you feel. Don't worry. Yeah, but Jesus said you don't have the ways to treat that remorse, actually. And repentance is the only way. Oh, well, yeah, I know, but I had a little talk with Jesus, and she says, and you know, he understands that. He said it's okay. You know, you can go along with this. It's okay. It'll be okay for you. Jesus says either way, you know, it's okay with him that, you know, he took a hard line, but I kind of convinced him that, you know, he needs to be a little more kind and considerate and compassionate to us. So he agreed, and he said, sure, you can go along this way. And that's that. You'll be happy there too. It's all fine. Huh? I don't know. Where'd you get that you had a little talk with Jesus and changed his mind? I don't, you know, where did that come from? Well, you know, mothers know these things. He's my son. I was able to talk with him and change his mind. You know, like I'm changing your mind right now. But you haven't really changed it yet. So if you haven't changed my mind, I kind of doubt you changed Jesus' mind. So, the Dharma Prince, the Guru Vision, is saying, hey, the gangster queen hasn't changed my mind at all. So if she hasn't changed my mind, don't you think she hasn't changed Jesus' mind either? Because she hasn't changed my mind because it's contrary to reason. I see it very clearly. So what? Jesus is not able to see that? I mean, who says that's nonsense? Only the gangster queen would say something such nonsense. I mean, Jesus is infinitely clearer than I am. There's no possibility he could stumble in such a way. And I'm not even stumbling, so how in the world could we think Jesus is stumbling? That's ridiculous. I mean, that's an absurdity, actually. I mean, that's like the most absurd stretch possible. Okay, so they're asking drying to dry our tears to accept the most absurd stretch possible, and then claiming that we're paranoid if we, you know, our tears are just due to paranoia. I mean, doesn't that sound like just a completely absurdist belief system that they're operating under? It sounds exactly that way. And if it sounds exactly that way, aren't we in our rights to say, nah, we're not quite ready to go in that direction? Don't we have a little wiggle room to say, well, not right now, maybe a little later, but, you know, I got to check into this a little more carefully as far, because it sure looks like a totally absurdist belief system. And that's exactly what Jesus warned us about and said it, that's what we're operating on. So far, Jesus hasn't made any mistakes. And I'm seeing you're making just massive mistakes. So I don't think that we're going to strike a deal right now, but maybe a little later we could strike a deal. That's possible. So we have to take that position because we don't have the clarity of Jesus at this point. Okay, and he doesn't expect us to. Okay, the gurus are not saying, oh, what's the matter with you? How come you can't take a more Adam position? No. So I was driving yesterday. I was talking about Jesus, and I said, you know, if Jesus is about ready to come back. And I said, and he wants us to be ready for him. Is there anyone here who's ready for him? And I said, Jesus, I'm ready for you right now. I don't know about later, but right now I'm ready for you. And then suddenly I started getting tears, and I realized Jesus was in tears, and he says, there's a student of mine right there. He says, I know you because you are a student of mine, because only a student of mine would respond to me in that way. So I said, Jesus, yeah, I'm ready for you right now, but later, I don't know about later, but right now I'm ready for you. And I can accept you right now. Later, I don't know, you know, if I can accept you or not, but I accept you right now. And there's a huge wow as I realized that right away Jesus says, I know you. I know who you are. You're one of my students. And you've been listening real good to me. Really, really, you absolutely, I know you've been paying attention. It's a proof. You just proved it. Because that's exactly the right response that shows that my teaching has borne fruit. Someone has passed my class, you know. That's the feeling I got. Jesus said, yeah. And I never said anything like that before. You know, we're all trying to take an absolute position. And I just said, well, I'm taking an absolute position right now. But, you know, later I can't really say one way or the other. We'll cross that bridge when we get to it. It's exactly the right approach to take. Because that's guru vision approach. Vision of oneness, vision of Christ approach, as Jesus would put it. That's let the grace of God drive your vehicle approach. I don't need to be a guru right now. It's not necessary. Let them gurus handle their business. Our business is vision of oneness, vision of sameness, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Guru vision. That's my business. That's our business. Okay, that's our role that we need to play now. We all have roles to play. That's our role. So you can say, yeah, I'm ready for guru vision right now. Later, I really can't speak to later, you know, whether I'll be accepting of it later or not. But right now, I'm accepting of it. And we'll see how it goes. I can't make any promises about quote-unquote later. And I'm not trying to determine later at all right now. I'm just all in right now, but I'm not making any promises to Jesus about later, but I'm all in right now. This is exactly what Jesus wants to hear. Exactly what the Dharma kings want to hear. So gather again, gather our nerve, full stop on the wow here. So we intentionally stop to gather our nerve, okay? We just take a break, put it on pause, gather our nerve. That's all. Doesn't that feel refreshing to be able to do that? Beautiful day here again It's every day is like Christmas here, as far as the weather goes. It's like, really? Another one? Never misses. Soft, soft little cool breeze, warm, beautiful, clear day, low humidity, high clarity, gentle feeling to it all. And yeah. Now, some people are trying to get dogs to drive their vehicle. A lot of people are. Say, wow, I got to trust in a dog to drive my vehicle. A lot of people are doing that. They're not going to the grace of the guru. They're going to an animal, dog, which they think, well, the dog, you know, is like super, be a super great driver. Really? You can have a dog? Dog is able to see through verticality, an illusion of all levels and stuff? Really? Or is the dog see nothing but levels? And so what's the dog going to do? The dog's not going to drive the vehicle at all. The dog's got to turn the vehicle off. And then you say, whew, man, at least I didn't flip over, you know, go vertical. Oh, man, that was scary. Yeah. No, the dog's going to just drive you into a ditch and that's it. So many people are putting their faith in dogs now. I mean, you know that. And animals. You know that. This means they're going to trust in a dog driving their vehicle because they know they can't do it. You know, we all know, whoa, going vertical, holy cow. Actually, those who are putting their faith in dogs, they're still driving their vehicle following the gangster queen, wannabe gangster queen, into the dark, this hideous realm. And they think the dog knows the way. The dog will follow her because she's trained the dog nicely. You know, because you see how the women can train dogs so well. Like, they do whatever they say, follow, follow me, follow me. Men too, but women seem to be really into it right now. Really, really into it. And so they think, oh, I'm confident the dog will be able to keep driving my vehicle, follow this. I don't want to lose sight of the gangster queen. She's the only joy hope I have. So that's why they're having the dogs drive their vehicle. Because in the back of their mind, they say, I kind of want to do a U-ey. You know, I really feel this desire to do a U-ey, but no, I can't do a U-turn. The gangster queen wouldn't like that. I'd lose sight of her. Holy cow. That would be scary. So the dog will keep me, you know, she'll whistle to the dog, and the dog will, you know, follow her. Here you go. Hey, come here. And the dog will drive you, keep driving your vehicle and keep following her, and she'll lead you into this, you know, scenario land of Gangstaville, wannabe Gangstaville. And she'll have you working on some wannabe Gangstaville project. And you'll think, oh, I'm really, really, we're really going to succeed. We're finally going to find happiness. Yeah. It's insane. Everybody's trying to buy a dog now, get hold of a dog. I need a dog. Holy cow. Something's attracting me away from the gangster goddess. Oh my God. This is really scary. I'm really scared. Yeah. That's continuity fear. It means you haven't been practicing all these years when you're supposed to be practicing. But you can still get it now. You can still do the U-turn. No problem at all. It's easy to do the U-turn. The tough part is when you start feeling the vertical, like, whoa. And then you got to go grace of the guru and hand the wheel over to the guru and turn your seat back, look at the world. It's all flat of judgment, flat of form depth, you know, appearance depth, 360 degreeness of intrinsic spaciousness, guru vision. Your mind is then peaceful and calm. So this is what I'm seeing in my contemplations. I'm able to see all this and look at it. I'm still not, you know, quote unquote, there yet. But, you know, we ease into it. I've had glimpses of it, and say, okay, gather your nerve. Just got to gather your nerve for this is all. So today's what, the 17th? Yeah, wow. Man, it's on. 18th. By the time we hit the 24th, it's going to be churning, gut churning. The gangster goddess is going to be pushing all the buttons. Incorporate. Let's just have one big old happy wannabe gangsta family. Okay? That's how we're going to succeed, folks. And the people will be, you know, the people who don't want to go off that will be like, and not quite seeing through it, they're going to get real agitated. And then, of course, those who want to go along, they'll get agitated in response. Say, hey, come on. We offered you a super reasonable deal, and you're not taking it. You're paranoid. You know, so we're gonna have to deal with you're too paranoid, you're ruining everything, so we're gonna have to like put you into re-education camps to cure you of your paranoia. And of course they're saying, oh, wait a minute. The deal that you offered me, we've just already seen that it's really backloaded in such a way as to kill our tree of faith. 100% for sure, actually. And that's not paranoid. We think that we're clear about, reasonably clear, and you're, criminals. Gangsta, wannabe gangsta criminals, actually, who wanna kill reality. And you wanna kill our faith in reality. And they'll say, no, you're paranoid and you need to be re-educated or exterminated, ultimately. They'll do the same thing, no, we're just re-educating you, but oh gosh, we need the food, some other people need the food and you've been eating more than your rations all this whole time, so we're very gonna be very reasonable with you here, and we're just gonna cut your rations until you balance the deficit's brought back up to zero, and then we'll start feeding you again. It's totally reasonable, right? Yeah, but by your way of accounting, that means I'm not gonna be able to eat for a couple years. Well, that's your problem. We're sorry about that, but you got the deficit by eating too much. Yeah, but you changed the regulations on me to give unreasonable low amounts of food. Well, that was because this is more important, obviously, and you haven't been re-educated enough to understand that. If you were re-educated enough to understand it, you wouldn't need to eat so much food and you wouldn't be complaining, you see? So they run the same scam in the re-education camps. Same thing, same thing. No, don't worry, we'll have plenty of food. But we do have some regulations, and some penalties, but we won't tell you what they are because you won't go over because you're sensible and we're sure that you'll be re-educated to understand and then we'll let you out and everything's fine. Sound familiar? Nazis. Exactly the kind of stuff that they engaged in. Liberal Nazi ideology, which our education system has been designed upon that. And that's what the liberals are actually about. Basically, they're Nazis, I have to tell you the truth about it. They really are. But they think they're super compassionate, reasonable people. And they're cutting a very good deal compromise. They've offered a super good compromise. And yet they hide the backloaded part of it, which is they want to exterminate you. That's why people are jittery. They know deep down what's happened throughout history. And again, the educational system, well, I've gone through this before. You get what I'm saying, so gather your nerve. Gather your nerve. Because this is what's coming now. Is cards are on the table, Bill. We're gonna have cards on the table. And this is when it all hits the fan. And everything seems fine until it really hits the fan. The fan hits it, and then it's just chaos, right? But we won't project how that chaos plays out. We just know it's coming. Trouble's coming. But we have to keep gathering our will here, gathering our nerve. Come on up. When this video's, most people be watching it on a Monday, I think the convention's going to already start at that point, I believe. Could be the 19th. I think it's the 18th, though. Where is it? Cleveland, I think. Interesting. Cleveland won a super surprising upset victory over the Golden State Warriors this year in basketball. Came back against great odds. Is that prophetic about what's going to happen? I don't know. But I can tell you this, if somehow Trump were elected president, the liberals would absolutely refuse to go along with it, and there'd be civil disobedience on a massive scale, and it wouldn't stop. They would never stop, because they're so committed to the gangster queen right now that it has to be done now, or else the world's gonna be, gonna die, that they will bring the whole government in the country to just a standstill. And they won't let up until Trump steps down. They won't. There'll be riots everywhere. And it won't stop. They won't stop. It'd be like civil war, actually. from because the liberals will do that. I mean, throughout history, everyone that's lost the election, they have to go along for 4 years. I mean, this is democracy. You can't have a democracy if people decide to pitch a civil war if someone, you know, they lose the election. But this is what they're planning. This is what they will do. I know the liberals very well. Growing up as a liberal in the 60s, civil disobedience, they shut down anything they wanted to shut down. They almost, you know, try to shut down the Pentagon. They will shut down anything they want to shut down through massive marches and riots and demonstrations and sabotage, etc. And you have civil war. And so they're using that as a threat for people, you know, not to elect Trump. And what Trump is saying, whoa, whoa, not so fast, folks. And we're not quite ready to, you know, join the, maybe a little later we'll join the gangster goddess. At least that's what he's representing. We're not sure what he will do, actually. He's getting the votes of those that hope he'll do that. But we don't know for sure if he'll do that. I'm not promising anything, you know, if he's elected. I don't, he's a wild card. You don't know exactly what he's going to do. But either way, you know, if he's elected, there's going to be chaos in the country. Because I know liberals, I'm telling you, I live in Liberalville, USA, Bay Area. Actually, I saw one Trump sign Friday, first one I've ever seen in this whole time, in a yard. And I just like, are you kidding me? One solitary little sign there in this yard. Poor person's yard, kind of, isn't it? Blue-collar, working-class family had a Trump sign. I said, wow, you're the only one. I wanted to stop and go in and shake their hand and say, wow, just from a sociological standpoint, that's pretty amazing. You know, isn't that amazing? But, so I know liberals, okay, and they are fanatics. Okay, they are absolute fanatics. If things don't go their way, because this is the only hope they have is the gangster queen, everyone goes along with her, and that's the only way she's going to release the secret to them. They think if they can get, she's told them, if you get everybody incorporated into one gangster group, then I'm going to release the secret to all of you. And so the liberals think that they're going to save the whole world because they think if they're going to get everybody into one gangster queen incorporated, and then she's going to release the answer to all of us, and we're all going to have the millennium and be happy ever after. Problem is, the answer she releases, we have to make time real. That's the thing you have to. And if you can't do that, she says, well, you're never going to be happy. How do you make time real? Well, mental chaos does it. Yeah, but you have to abide in mental chaos. Well, I can't do that. Well, you're just not a. You're defective, then, she'll tell you. You're defective. I know all this. I've been through it all. This is what she'll tell you. The ego, but the way it pragmatically plays out in this world is we project a archetype as the gangster goddess. So, again, if Trump is they're blackmailing the whole country, saying if Trump is elected, you won't have a country anymore. Plain and simple. We will refuse to honor anything. And they'll start being like activists, like the weathermen and all that kind of stuff. You'll find out that the country will be under siege and attack from within. And they will, you will be blackballed. You know, if you voted for Trump, they will firebomb your house. They'll attack you. They'll do everything. They're fanatics. They're absolute revolutionary fanatics. If it doesn't go their way. If it goes their way, they seem to be really nice. Because they're hoping, oh, good, I'm going to be happy because I pulled you into the fold. Wow, aren't I fortunate? Aren't we all fortunate? The gangster queen's going to release the secret to us as soon as we get everybody in. But if we let any stray sheep, oh, no. Oh, so then she's not going to release it. Pretty tough parameters, huh? And of course, we're not going to pull everybody in. So she'll say, well, I can't release it to you yet because someone got away, you failed here and there, but I'm going to give you some of the secret, you know. And you go, oh, thank you, you know. But we really want all the secrets. Just, well, not quite, you didn't quite succeed, but if you, you know, if you just a little work, a little more, you will succeed. It's just our way of delaying. She's a delaying vice, the gangster queen. Wannabe gangster queen is just a delaying device, an archetypal delaying device that we're using our psyche to just keep on delaying us all, really. This is fun. I mean, spilling the beans is fun. It's scary at the same time, right? Because we're painting a scenario, you know this is going to happen. I mean, if you think that the Vietnam and civil rights war protests and the gay pride, protests and all these protests, abortion, whatever it is, well, they weren't protesting that because they got the judgment, the victory on that one. But if you think all of the liberal protests throughout the last 60 years or so, feminism and all that stuff, and the sabotage and stuff, if you think that was bad, which it was horrible. That's you ain't seen nothing yet. You haven't seen nothing yet. I mean, they will just lose their minds, actually. I know they will. There's not the one side in the whole Bay Area for Trump. I mean, this just shows you that everyone's so terrified here. They know, what would happen if Trump's elected and you have a Trump sign in your yard. You know what's going to happen. You are going to be absolutely targeted. The ones that were against gay marriage, for instance, were absolutely targeted by the liberals. Absolutely, they were targeted in all sorts of ways, blackballed in all sorts of ways. They get totally vicious, and then to the point of destroying you. Throughout history, this is what's happened. Those who follow the gangster queen, when it doesn't go their way or they want to force things, they become, the exterminators. They put you in gas chambers. You say, what happened to these nice liberals, these nice, wonderful people that I thought were so kind to me? Well, because they were trying to market this lie to me. Of course, they're trying to be nice to you and they're marketing this lie. Don't worry, you can keep feeding the plant of your tree of faith. We're not against you. We just need to put some regulations on it. That's all. So of course, when they're trying to get you to buy into a lie, they're going to seem to be very nice. But if you decide not to buy into it, then the club comes out. On the other hand, the caveman club, the cavewoman club. It turns out they're in the Stone Age. In terms of judgment, they say they're not judge, they're tolerant, they're not non-judgmental, inclusive. No, they're inclusive. Yeah, they want to include you in their one, gangster queen, incorporated, united, gangster queen united. They want you to be they're inclusive. Everyone be included in this, in the one gangster club, and we can all gang up together. Of course, they say they're inclusive. Of course, they're tolerant. They tolerate bringing in everybody into their little club, even if you used to have some kind of weird faith in God or something. But we're tolerant. You can come into our little gangster queen united. See how tolerant and inclusive we are? We include everybody in it, and we're tolerant of everybody that comes in, except we're completely intolerant of someone not coming in. Whoops. But we gave you a reasonable deal, so it's not really intolerance. It's just, we just have got to have some rules and regulations, and it's just to help you. And maybe we're sorry, but we're still really kind and tolerant. It's just we got to exterminate you because, you couldn't be re-educated. But, that's, that doesn't mean we're bad people at all. Come on, come on. You were just trying to destroy our happiness, so that's just you brought it upon yourselves is what really happened. This is their rationale. This is their rationale. I know, and we know that. We know that. Historically, the historic record is very clear on this. And guess what? Mental dynamics don't change. The definition of insanity is have the same effects and expect a different result. You've got the exact same effects that have continually been playing throughout history, and we're expecting a different result here. That's insanity. So the country is going to be under just insane pressure. And globally, it's the same thing. This is a global movement, actually. The idea of the rest of the country, the world, that we might elect Trump, they'd say, well, if that happens, we're going to just blackball the United States entirely, jump on China's bandwagon, and crush the country economically in every which way possible. We're actually going to destroy it because we cannot have this delay. We can't have any delay. They claim it's environmental. Like if we don't do something drastic right now, the whole planet's going to die. So they tie it into environmentalism, which is bogus because we can easily do something environmentally with the conservatives in charge and probably do it a lot better job, actually. Yeah, no, they're just using the environmental excuse to, they tied their agenda to it to claim that if their agenda doesn't go through, then the world's going to die. Like you won't do anything, you'll ruin the environment. They're ruining the environment more than anybody, actually. Because their teaching leads to materialism, materialistic mindset, which causes more consumerism, actually, whereas the more conservative approach is able to deal with austerity a lot better. A lot better, actually. They say, hey, you know what? I want to keep my car for like 30 years. That's okay. It's a nice car. Yeah, give me a nice car, but let me drive for 30 years. No problem. I have no problem with that, actually. The liberals, they want a new car every year, you know, every 2 years or something. Oh, electric car? Let me get that electric car. Yeah, but what all the rare metals and stuff they're using to the batteries and everything? Oh, no, no, no. It's good for the environment. Yeah, what about electricity? You got to burn coal for that. No, 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 no. I need a new car. I need a new car. They actually use more resources. They will never admit that, of course, but it's true. Overall, it's a negative effect. So, tying politics to the environment the way they have is another scam that they're using. I'm not saying that the environment's not in trouble. It is. But they're not the only ones that can fix it, by any means. Reasonable people can do a better job fixing it than unreasonable people, actually. Because they're just using that as a spiritual, you know, as a threat to demand spiritual capitulation for everyone. And actually, you know, we can we can just see that, you know, save the world from us. We don't need to save the world. We need to save the world from us, so to speak. Or we need to liberate the world from our demands that it act as an excuse for us, you know, for our arrogance. That's what really saves the world, is our own salvation saves the world. That's the only way to save the world. It's the only way to save the world, actually. Keep in mind that a lot of these liberals are young people, and in the 60s, 70s, those are the radicals, the young people. The young people can be extremely radical. They have the older people, radicals, guiding them, and they can really bring about a lot of mayhem, a lot of sabotage, a lot of problems. This is just what's going to happen. This is what's happening. This is what we're facing. Again, the liberals will never accept a Trump presidency. They will not accept it. And a lot of people won't accept a liberal Clinton presidency either, but they'll be able to push that through more easily because the conservatives tend not to go along and say, well, you know, we've got to save our Constitution. We don't want to subvert the Constitution. The liberals have no hesitation to throw the Constitution down, flush it down the toilet. They would flush it down the toilet today if they could. They think it gets in their way, gets in the way of their agenda. And I'm just telling you this from just experience, clarity, and just tell it like it is. I don't, you know, for me, of course, it's guru vision is what saves us all. But I'm saying we're in for a rocky road going forward here. Okay, I'm just pointing out, we're in for a real rocky road. I won't be out there protesting one way or the other. Okay, if you think that's what I'm about, no. I'll do my best to be shining guru vision to everyone. Don't know where I'll be or how I'll do it. May have to take refuge, you know, as the gangsta, the wannabe gangsta's gonna get real down and dirty, you know. Hey, we got to round everybody up here and make sure that they, we'll help you incorporate. Don't worry. We'll help you incorporate. Sure, you got to shut down your little bank, but that's okay. We'll reopen it and you'll just be part of our big bank and that'll work out great for you. Yeah, but we're not quite sure that being part of your big bank is the best, you know, best thing for our destiny. Oh, we'll be very fair and reasonable. Don't worry. Don't worry, huh? Well, I am worrying. Well, why are you worrying? Well, Jesus kind of told, we love Jesus too, but, you know, Jesus wasn't quite aware of, you know, how things are going to go in this time and age. So, you know, don't worry. I think he was aware of how it all works. So, well, you know, you need a little re-education. We'll take care of that. We got some medicine for you. No problem. No problem. Got plenty of medicine for you. I don't think I really want to hang around in this little tree fort right now. You know, maybe later I will, but not right now. I'll let the Dharma King, I'll let the Dharma Bodhisattvas and apostles and saints and drive my, you know, I'll let my bus driver, the grace of God is driving my bus in the guise of someone, Jamyon Kenzi Choki Lodro. I'll let them drive this vehicle, this tank, I'll trust them that they're going to drive it to the right place, and you know, I'll just shine guru vision, and where I end up is where I end up. Have faith in that. How's the ride been so far? A little more than you expected? Probably, right? A little more than you expected. It always is. It's more than I expected. I kind of expected some, most of it. Otherwise, I couldn't do the video. But it's been, pretty eye-opening for me too. It's like, wow. You start speaking truth and wow. It gets very truthful. So I don't put any faith in somebody putting it all right, a politician putting it all right, because there'll be assassins on every corner of Trump's elected president. Every liberal will have in their hearts that they have to take him out. Every single one of them will. And somebody's going to, many people will try to be a hero to them. Definitely. I mean, the gangster goddess will say, hey, you want to be saved, you got to be a hero. And if you're a hero, I'll shed my grace upon all of you and give you the answer. And she always promises that. So, how long would it last, the presidency, right? You have to think that, how long will it really last? Look at Kennedy, how long did he last? So, either, and then if that happens, it's just, the country's just going to implode, really. And, it's just on and on and on. There's no way that it's going to be smoothed out, really, except for, if the conservatives all capitulate, or they round them all up and put them in re-education camps or something. I don't know how it's going to go. I don't really want to think too much about exactly how it's going to go. But it's not going to be nice. the everybody's so frustrated because the gangster goddess has wannabe gangster goddess has never given us the answer, and we're really frustrated. She says, "Yeah, I know you're frustrated, but you're almost there." She really likes that one. "I know you're really frustrated, but you're almost there. And all you got to do is incorporate everybody, and then I'll give you the answer. It's easy, real simple, right? I'm real straightforward with you, right?" "Yeah, but you're not very straightforward because many have already escaped this tree fort thing, and they're not going to be incorporated under any circumstances, so it's an impossible task you're giving us. I mean, Jesus, we're not going to be able to bring Jesus back." "Well, you got to try. I mean, at least you can try, right?" "Yeah, but I'm really frustrated. I want the answer now because it seems like you're stalling me again." So people are very frustrated with the wannabe gangster goddess. They're very frustrated. So they're going to make one big more push to please her, which of course has no chance of pleasing her from the get-go. But they don't want to see that because they don't want to admit that, like, they've been fooled. But they're only fooling themselves, just out of a sense of silliness and absurdity and adventurousness, So repentance is not painful, really. We think it will be, but it's not. It's actually a great relief. You say, okay, that was silly. Why did I do that? That was really silly. I just wanted to have fun. Okay, no problem. No problem. And so, then don't hold your breath waiting for them to repent right now. They're more into the mode of one last big push to please the wannabe gangster goddess. So she will release the fragrance of her grace and her secrets will be made. Her secrets will be revealed to us. Yeah, all you got to do is make time real. I don't know how to do that. Well, we'll have to work on it here. More bodies, more worlds, more bodies, more consumerism, more things, more regulations. You can do it. Come on. Yeah, but we're frustrated. Well, if you just got everybody in to the fold, then you'd get the answer. So the frustration of the liberals is being turned towards you and you and me and you. Of any of those who have faith, their frustration is being channeled towards them instead of towards the wannabe gangster goddess, which is where it should be channeled towards. And towards them suddenly run out of patience. "Hey, wait a minute. I just don't think I can trust you. I'm going to turn to the grace of God and start listening to the grace of God, the Holy Spirit," which is what I did. I turned to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit has started, setting me straight and clear and like, wow. Thank you very much, Holy Spirit. Their frustration, we're in the crosshairs of their frustration right now. Not a good place to be. Not a good place to be. So it's great to have a Dharma key you really trust in. And they can either drive your vehicle or recommend one who they know will do the right job for you. That they know for sure that this will work for you. They'll drive it no mistakes. They can recommend someone. Absolutely they will. That you feel comfortable with as your bus, as your vehicle driver, your tank driver. Yeah. It's like, what am I doing driving a tank? Well, that's the image you're bristling with, wannabe gangsterness. Oh, okay. As long as you're driving it, I know it won't be a problem. Won't try to use it in any way. Welcome home. So we just gather our nerve after hearing something like this. It's just like, wow, what a nice synopsis of the whole thing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Dharma Kings. Thank you, God, for this wonderful synopsis and clarification. And if we say, where do we go from here? Well, we go on the wow for a while, right? We just let the wow just percolate and say, wow. Had that, well, let's just stay in the wow before we say anything else. Just stay in the wow. We're getting near the end of the video, so we can start realizing it's winding down here. I was going to quit Facebook today because it's just all dualist, positivist dualist is just all that's happening. I realize what's going on. They're like trying to bring me into the fold, the gangster wannabe gangster goddess fold. And I'm wondering, should I just hang in there and help them? Maybe they want to leave it and they just need some help. And I asked Jam, yeah, the next friend that shows up, that's going to be the answer. And what showed up was this really, really strict non-dualist. It's like friend request. It's like, whoa. Now, is that itself? Was that just a ploy to keep me hanging in there so they can keep trying to sabotage me or what? I don't know. It can work that way too. We'll see if he's actually serving the gangster goddess. Wannabe gangster goddess. I have to keep saying that. She's not a real gangsta at all. We think that she's actually a real gangsta, but she's not. She's still a wannabe. But she's our idealized image of what a real gangster would be like. You see, we have this idealized image of what a real gangster would be like. And the wannabe gangster goddess is our idealized image of what a real gangster would look like. So we think that she really is a real gangster. So we idolize her and worship her and think, oh my gosh, I know she can help me. I really know she can help me. Because she's so smooth. I mean, she just seems to not be bothered by it. She doesn't have any doubts or just, but. We're looking at the superficial, of course. Inside, she's completely, deceptive and a liar and a deceiver. But superficially, she looks like she's got this gangsta thing all figured out. So, most of us, deep down, we're still, going along with that. I seem to be going along with it a lot less than most at this point. That's how I view myself. And turned away from that. Spilling the beans on the gangsta, wannabe gangsta queen. But you might realize that all the people in your life want to be gangsters. It's like, whoa. So that's what's been going on in my life. Yeah, certainly it has, because they're really worried about me. The world is very, the little treehouse wannabe gangster clubs has always been very worried about me. They said, wow, this could ruin our plans. I mean, he seems to be pretty independent, really independent. A maverick, we can't pin him down. This is scary. He makes us feel jittery. So how do we get him in to the fold? they've tried everything, you know, really they have. It's amazing at all the tactics they've used. Ganged up in this way, ganged up in this way, deceitfully this way, this way, this way. Ah, so many different ways. Let's get rid of him, you know, that way too. Many, 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 many plots and subplots to get me into the fold, try to shepherd me into the fold. You know, they're still working at it feverishly. Feverishly. So, wow, Jam Yang, you know, it's your time to drive, brother. Just get driving. Get that bus, get this vehicle headed in the right direction. Of course, when he's driving it, every direction is the right direction. It's 360 degrees, perfect direction. So the road suddenly feels smooth. Like, it's like you're on like a pothole road, you know, out in the boondocks. Your vehicle's rattling around. And suddenly you go on this super smooth asphalt, which is the smoothest. It's like, ah, what happened? It's so smooth. I feel everything so smooth now. Wow. Feels like nirvana, you know. There's no depth to the road. It's all smooth. There's no levels, you know, pothole levels to the road. It's all smooth. So that's what I'm counting on. So Jam Yang driving the vehicle. It's all smoothed out. You know, I'm praying for that right now, you know, today. And politically, basically what's been going on for quite some time is basically the liberals telling everybody, look, this is what we're going to do if you don't go along with our plans. We're not going to do it yet, but we're giving you a warning. And from their rationale, which is the criminal rationale, is if we give you warning ahead of time, then there's no guilt in what we do. I mean, you should have listened to our warning, and you did it anyway, so we're totally justified in doing whatever what we warned you about. Even if what they warned you about was like totally atrocious, they don't have any. They say, we don't have any guilt. We warned you about it ahead of time. This is the criminal mode. They say, well, we warned you we're gonna do this if you don't go along and do the things we told you to do. Even if it's extortion, they say, oh, you didn't do what we told you. We warned you, so there's no guilt on our heads. We're not breaking any law. They have their own law, the law of the criminals, the gangster law. And so they don't feel any conscience or guilt or anything. They say, no, we're fine. We're good. We warned you we'd re-educate you if you didn't do what we told you to do. And so, hey, you didn't listen. That's your fault, not ours. Classic gangster logic. And so they've been busy warning us all. You know, I just stopped paying attention. I used to pay attention. I said, wow, they're really going to be nasty, huh? And I realized that, you know, whatever. You know, why pay attention to their warnings, you know? I'm not going to follow it anyway, so do what they say anyway. So, you know, either I, you know, get free of it or not. You know, they can't bully me into doing what they say at all. So why waste time listening to all their warnings? I know that, you know, it's not going to convince me, not going to scare me into following them anyway. The people that are paying attention to, what they're trying to do is trying to scare themselves into compliance. Say, well, maybe I better not, you know, go against their wishes. And maybe I better convert myself somehow. It's like the Nazis telling the Jews, look, if you just, you know, wear a star, do this, do this, and this, and this, everything will be fine with you, don't worry. And then some Jews said, that's just a trick. You know, that's just a trick. Don't trust them. Don't trust them. Yeah, well, right? Don't trust that. Don't trust them. We're gathering our nerve here. We don't want to keep going on. What is this, dude? I got a little time to gather our nerve. Yeah. It's weird. My icon on Facebook doesn't show up. It's just broken. And someone else is also a non-dualist, their icon is broken too. It doesn't show. Everyone else's icons show, and our two icons refuse to show up. Very interesting. means you're not going joining gangster, you know, Gangsterville, little the Treefort wannabe gangster gang. Gangster Goddess United. Gangster Goddess United. It fits. The shoe fits entirely. Speaking of shoes fitting, I have these pair of shoes. A great pair of shoes. I got them a half size small, and I go barefoot in them, no socks. This is great. It's super comfortable for around the house. But if you do a lot of walking, it rubs your toes, and you get sore spots on your toes. The socks prevent that, you know. So I have to get really thin socks to wear, but even then they get a little tight. But as far as going just sockless, oh, they're great. Awesome shoes. Golf shoes. You say, what? Why wear golf shoes? Because you can replace the cleats, you know, so your sole never wears out. How about that? Pretty cool, huh? The best shoes in the world are golf shoes, actually. Put a lot of effort to making those shoes really sturdy. They're waterproof. I mean, the late everything. They really do a great job on golf shoes. And so, you're going to wear out the cleats. You just get another set of cleats for $15 or something. Put brand new cleats in. And the sole never touches the ground at all. It's the cleats. And so you can just wear those golf shoes for years and years and years and years. It's like an unbelievable secret, huh? As far as that's to save money, yeah. It's like awesome. Nobody's thought of that idea. I just wear golf shoes everywhere. It's the best. And the cleats grab beautifully. Traction's wonderful everywhere. The other shoes, they last like, you know, 6 months or so, or a year, but they're worn out. The soles are worn out and everything. No. These golf shoes are so durable. It's unbelievable how durable they are. They're designed to stand up to some heavy-duty walking, right, and conditions and for golfers. So another thing is razors. Again, I've used the same razor starting in January. So 7 months, basically January, February, March, April, May, June. That's 6 months going into July, halfway through July. 6.5 months, basically. Call it 6 months. Half a year, same razor. Still cuts fine. Why? How do I do this? This is another secret. Nobody tells you about it. Someone told me about this, and I tried it, and it works. How about that? Trying something, and it works. After you shave, you shake off, you clean it, you get everything, you know, and then shake off all the water. Like, shake like this. Shake, 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 shake. Strong, you know, to shake off. And then on a towel or a tissue paper or a towel, blot all the remaining water off the tips of the blades. Okay, so it's totally dry, and then put it upside down so the blades are standing up instead of pointing downwards. The blades, the arm is resting on the arm and the blades are pointing upwards, okay? What it does is it keeps all the water from drying on the edge of the blades, which, and the water has minerals in it, okay, which corrode the blades. So if you prevent any water from drying on the blades stay sharp. And again, it's still sharp. 6 months, it's still sharp. I don't have a problem at all shaving with it. It's still sharp. 6 months. I bought a pack of 8 blades. So that's what lasts me at least 4 years. It's like blades are like $30-something, eight or something. But that's pretty good. $37 for 8 years. That's not bad, huh? Not bad at all. So is this ready to stop? Or is it still going? It's still going? Maybe it stopped.
I don't know.
Yeah. It says it's still catching. So, but there's a little tip for our, to save money on shoes and razor blades. How about that? It's better than Martha Stewart here. I'll tell you that. It really works. It really works.
Is it still going?
It's still going. Okay. Oh my gosh. It's still going. It's doing weird stuff right now though. It's jumping all over. It's just jumping all over the place. Crazy. Which means we're getting towards, you know what? The world becoming very weird and awkward, right? Very weird and awkward. Which is fine. Gather our nerve, gather our nerve, gather our nerve. Hey, gather our nerve, gather our nerve, gather our nerve. And it does say it's still going. Isn't that amazing? We got through the entire thing by just keeping our cool and faith. It just went through incredible indications that it had quit on me. And I just said, no, 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 no. It It still hasn't completely indicated that it stopped, and it looks like it indeed it is still recording. Isn't that amazing? So, there's a perfect example of getting through a very awkward, weird time, having faith. That tree of faith you have in your yard growing, that's the most important tree you have. Don't make any deals. There's deals about that tree are off the table. We don't make deals on our tree of faith at all. No deals, because Jesus has told us don't ever make deals on that tree of faith in terms of that a compromise sort of thing, right? Like, don't keep watering it. Just keep watering it. Keep watering it. Smooth it out. I mean, the fruit, you got to start tasting the fruit. I mean, as it ripens, you'll get wiser and wiser and wiser and realize that you used to, you know, some of your ideas were still kind of gangsterish. Yeah, of course. Jesus told us that would happen. That we'd have to keep the Holy Spirit would clarify it for us, and we'd say, "Oh wow, okay, I don't need that. That was gangsterish. I'm setting that down. That was gangsterish. Setting that down." And that's the path of repentance: is your setting your mistakes down, setting your wannabe gangster attitudes down. I'm still working to set mine down. We all are, okay. And it gets clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer, and you get less and less fooled by the ego. Okay, so, but don't make that deal with the devil on your tree of faith. Say, no, that's non-negotiable. I'm going to water it as much as I want to water it. And if you want to punish me, fine, but I'm not making a deal with you. So if you want to come down and try to penalize me, you're going to have to face my resistance on that one. Okay? I'm not making